Chapter 7. The Terror of the Machine. Same thing, Dave. justice and humanity in industry. If we cannot have these qualities, then we were better off without industry. Indeed, if we cannot get those qualities, the days of industry are numbered. But we can get them. We are getting them. If a man cannot earn his keep without the aid of machinery, is it benefiting him to withhold that machinery because attendance upon it may be monotonous and let him starve? Or is it better to put him in the way of a good living? Is a man the happier for starving? If he is the happier for using a machine to less than its capacity, is he happier for producing less than he might, and consequently getting less than his share of the world's goods in exchange? I have not been able to discover that repetitive labor injures a man in any way. I have been told by parlor experts that repetitive labor is soul, as well as body destroying, but that has not been the result of our investigations. There was one case of a man who all day long did little but step on a treadle release. He thought that the motion was making him one-sided. The medical examination did not show that he had been affected, but of course, he was changed to another job that used a different set of muscles. In a few weeks, he asked for his old job again. It would seem reasonable to imagine that going through the same set of motions daily for 8 hours would produce an abnormal body, but we have never had a case of it. We shift men wherever they ask to be shifted, and we should like regularly to change them. That would be entirely feasible. Probably the most cross-section of its employees to show about the same proportions as a cross-section of a society in general. We have always with us the maimed and the halt. There is a most generous disposition to regard all of these people who are physically incapacitated to labor as a charge on society and to support them by charity. There are cases where I imagine that the support must be charity, as, for instance, an idiot. But those cases are extraordinarily rare, and we have found it possible, among the great number of different tasks that must be performed somewhere in the company, to find an opening for almost anyone, and on the basis of production, a blind man or crippled can, in the particular place to which he is assigned, perform just as much work and receive exactly the same pay as a wholly able-bodied man would. We do not prefer cripples, but we have demonstrated that they can earn full wages. It would be quite outside the spirit of what we are trying to do to take on men because they were crippled, pay them at a lower wage, and be content with a lower output. That might be directly helping the men, but it would not be helping them in the best way. The best way is always the way by which they can be put on a productive par with able-bodied men. I believe that there is very little occasion for charity in this world. That is, charity in the sense of making gifts. Most certainly business and charity cannot be combined. The purpose of a factory is to produce, and it ill serves the community in general unless it does produce to the utmost of its capacity. We are too ready to assume, without investigation, that the full possession of faculties is a condition requisite to the best performance of all jobs. To discover just what was the real situation, I had all of the different jobs in the factory classified to the kind